In our series on CSS grid layout, we have explored how to use grid template rows, grid template columns, and grid areas to define a grid structure. We have also looked at different properties for aligning grid items and the grid itself. In this video, we are diving into named grid lines and creating a web page layout using advanced features of CSS Grid. If you haven't already, subscribe to the channel and ring the notification bell to stay updated on upcoming tutorials. Welcome to Optimistic Web, where we explore the world of CSS and front-end development, one step at a time. Our page starts with a top bar, which can be used for announcements, taglines, or secondary navigation. Following that, the website header serves as a wrapper for the logo and the main navigation. And then we have a hero section, the main content area, and the footer, completing the overall layout. Now let's quickly walk through the CSS I've prepared for this mini project. In addition to some typography styles, the header is set as a flex container to keep the logo and navigation in their respective places. Then we have presentational styles for the navigation, hero section, main content area, and footer. There is also a banner that we will work with to create a breakout effect. Since we are focusing on CSS grid properties, the first thing we need to do is convert our page into a grid container. If you don't prefer to mess with the body element, you can add an extra wrapper and use that as the container for the grid layout. The second step is to define the rows and columns. Since I am unsure of how many rows the page will need, and I don't want to set a fixed number of rows, we can skip that part and let the browser auto-generate the row tracks. The grid template columns property is what we will mainly focus on today. Using the CSS rule, we are creating a 5-column layout, where the first and last columns use the min-max function, setting a minimum width of 3 rem and a maximum of 1 fr. The second and fourth columns will maintain a width of 1 fr, which means one fraction of the available space. And then, the middle column, the third one, uses the min function to set the minimum of 100% or 80 characters, whichever is smaller. Let's break this down a bit more. The 3 rem space which we are using for the first and last columns will serve as a minimum gutter for the page. To keep things organized, we can store this value in a CSS variable, making it easier to reuse wherever needed. Since the middle column can expand up to 100%, it needs to respect the gutter space to prevent a horizontal scroll bar. We can use the same CSS variable and subtract twice the gutter space from 100% to keep everything tidy. Now let's revisit the grid column property that we used in previous videos to position different parts of the grid into their respective cells. In this case, we are using grid line numbers to finalize the structure. For instance, the top bar will start at the first column grid line and extend to the last column grid line. Similarly, the header, hero, and footer sections will span across their respective rows. However, the content section will start at the third column grid line and occupy a single column. While there's nothing wrong with using grid line numbers and the front end is also looking good, it can be challenging to keep track of the line numbers. Additionally, we need to be aware of the fact that the line numbers reverse if the site is displayed in a different writing mode, such as right to left or in a vertical orientation. To solve this issue, CSS allows us to name grid lines and use those names instead of numbers when laying them out on the grid. Similar to how we assign custom names to grid areas, we can apply a similar technique to grid lines. Line names can be anything we choose, except the keyword span. Like in this example, we are using square bracket syntax to name the grid lines. The first and last grid lines are named page. The second and fifth will be identified as breakout. And the third and fourth are labeled as content. If we inspect this setup in the DevTools, each column grid line shows a name. There is no need to remember line numbers anymore, which can be helpful, especially when dealing with complex page layouts. This technique applies to both column and row grid lines. While we are focusing on column lines for this project, row lines can also have custom names. The next step is to use these names to position the different parts of the grid in their correct places. For example, the top bar can now start at page, which is the first grid line, and span across 5 columns. In this case, we use the name for the column start line, but the column end line is still based on numbers. It would be more streamlined if we could use names for both starting and ending positions. If we verify the grid setup, both the first and last lines share the same name. In such cases, where multiple lines share the same name, we can reference them by their name and count. So in this case, the column start line can be referenced as page 1 and the end line as page 2. This setup can be confusing because we are still working with numbers and tracking the count of similar names. To make it more intuitive, we can add start and end keywords to the line names. For example, the first line name will be page start, while the last line name will be page end. The rest of the grid lines can also be modified in the same way, giving each a clear starting and ending name. We can even assign multiple names to a single grid line. For instance, the first line could have two names, page start and call 1 start. The second line could have three names, breakout start, call 1 end, and call 2 start, and so on. The advantage of adding start and end keywords to the line names is that we can now use the first part of the line name as a named area. This eliminates the need to specify the value for grid column end. Similarly, the header, hero, and footer sections will span the full page width, while the content block will only cover the content width. Now let's move on to another exciting part of this technique. In our HTML, the banner section is contained inside the main block. We can easily break this section out of its parent element by using advanced grid placement techniques. First of all, the main section needs to be modified to cover the entire page width instead of being constrained. It will then be set as a subgrid to inherit the same column setup from its parent grid. Now, all direct children of the content block can use the same line names we defined for the parent grid element. So in this example, all direct child elements of the content CSS class will remain within the content width. And now we can throw the magic of the subgrid to pull the banner section out of its fixed width parent. The possibilities are endless. Each section of the grid can now function as an independent module. The banner section can be styled not only as a breakout or full width element, but can also have custom starting and ending positions. For instance, the banner now extends from the content width to the far right of the browser window, creating a unique one-sided breakout design without relying on any negative margin hacks. With a single line of CSS, we can change the layout of any part of the page without affecting other areas. The header can have a full width layout, while the hero section can be styled as a fixed width section. The banner is free to fly in both directions, creating a dynamic and visually appealing design that enhances the overall user experience. This flexibility allows us to craft layouts that are not only functional, but also captivating, making it easier to adapt to various content needs and aesthetic preferences. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe for more. Feel free to leave your questions or comments below. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.